after the crash of Davidson and Brown's plane. But what purpose would a hoax serve? Kenneth Arnold had his own sighting story that brought him all the publicity he needed. Here he is shaking hands with President Eisenhower while running for Lieutenant Governor of Idaho. A doll quickly went quiet about Moy Island and Chrisman disappeared. The Air Force never conducted a thorough investigation of the Davidson-Brown crash. It never officially concluded that Moy Island was a hoax. It said only that material like that slag that had disappeared from then on out would be processed to the Air Force's Foreign Technologies Desk. And an interesting footnote to the ufologist out there is that's the same place that Philip Corso, who wrote a book called The Day After Roswell, claimed they parceled out the technological benefits that had been back engineered for the Roswell crash. John Keel came to believe that the hoax was perpetuated to cover up radioactive waste dumping from the nearby Hanford nuclear plant. Chrisman did indeed briefly get a job at the Hanford plant after Moy Island, so this theory posits that this was his reward for muddying up the waters, so to speak, when Dahl and his crew accidentally stumbled upon and witnessed this nuclear dumping. As you can tell from this map, however, Moy Island is fairly to the north of Puget Sound, and in all likelihood, dumping would have taken place further south, down by the Columbia River. So, we are left with the unified saucer theory, or something like it, something very close to Chrisman's own theory. In the 1960s, Chrisman spoke at several UFO conferences and corresponded with a few ufologists. He claimed that his then-current television series, and again, I have a pilot episode of this on DVD out there if you want to investigate it further. You can notice here, too, those of you who are specialists in this recognize that this is an Adamski craft with the bell under it. Adamski was one of the 1950s contactees. I just went over this. I just got in from the Mojave Desert at the Integra time. He claimed that this then-current television series about a man brought into various adventures because of what he knows about a secret alien invasion was largely based on his life. The show was on the air at the same time Jim Garrison was pursuing Chrisman over JFK. And it was recently revealed that another program called the FBI, from the same producers, which is Quinn Martin Productions, used secret government contacts as consultants on the show, most notably a guy named Mark Felt, the man who is now identified as Watergate's famous deep throat. John Kennedy gave one final speech on the day that he died, concerned the contract for the TFX tactical fighter. This was an extremely controversial contract that everyone expected to go to Boeing in Seattle, in Washington, but that JFK instead awarded to General Dynamics. Garrison believed that Chrisman's secret masters belonged to the military aerospace industrial complex. And at this point in time, you could certainly add Boeing to the list of people and groups that might have wanted Kennedy dead. It doesn't contradict the oft-stated idea that Kennedy was killed because he was pulling America out of Vietnam, since that meant a huge dent in the profits of this same axis of power, we'll call the MIC, military industrial complex. The TFX eventually became the F-111 and was eventually sold to Australia, opening up a funding corridor that led to the development of Pine Gap, Australia's Area 51. And then this turns our attention again to that somehow secret but well-known base out in the New Mexico desert, and to the biography of Lee Harvey Oswald. Oswald served in Atsugi, Japan, out of which the U-2 planes were flown. He defected to the Soviet Union at a time when he possibly gave them the necessary information to shoot down Gary Powers, U2, and before he got the job at the book depository, he worked for Chandler Charles Stovall, a photographic firm that processed U2's high-altitude photographs. So Oswald was basically a spy connected to the U2 program, and of course the U2 was developed in Area 51. So that's where the road from Moy Island finally leads to. But of course, we really can't say that it ends there, because even now, we still only dimly understand all this part of our past, and of course, our present, and our future. So, I think I'm doing pretty good on time now, and I've pretty much covered all the basic points, so maybe we can have a Q&A if you have questions. When Howard Hunt died, he didn't really make an outright confession. Everything he said was really kind of cryptic. Yeah, he passed it on to his son. This is his dear voice on that. Yeah. So, a spy is an end. You know, he was never direct, right? And when I give this presentation elsewhere, I actually go up close and personal and show a picture of Hunt and a picture of the tramp that they think is Hunt. And the photographic evidence there is alarmingly clear. But also, very interestingly enough, both of those guys look like the actor Jack Lemmon. So,
I've got a big question for you, which is basically, why do you think Kennedy was shot? What was the reason behind the assassination?
Well, as I said, the kind of standard view is that because he was pulling us out of Vietnam, and you see a clear record that he had signed an executive memoranda reducing the number of advisors in Vietnam as part of the beginning of getting us all out of there, and that threatened the military-industrial complex. And I think in the particulars of this case, one wing of that complex was with Boeing, you know, had been offended.